Pretty good happy hump day. Today is Wednesday, December 11, 2019, and you're watching the Daily Mix TV. Hi, my name is Sean Patrick Hillman. So I've gotten all of your messages, and honestly, you guys are fantastic. I love you so much. As many of you know, I have walking pneumonia. So it's producing a lot of fluid in my lungs that unfortunately makes it very hard to breathe, let alone talk for long periods of time. So that's why I haven't been doing an episode, and that's why my voice sounds the way that it does. So I'm going to try and get through today's episode. We'll see what happens. But, you know, the amount of messages and emails and texts that I've gotten from you guys, you know, asking why am I not doing it? Am I okay? You know, you want some advice on, you know, certain stories that have been coming out. I can't tell you how much that's made me feel so much better. On top of that, I've been reading the news and looking online and seeing all of the stories that I just want to give people advice on and help you capitalize on what's going on. It's such an interesting time period in marketing and business and pop culture. So let's get on to the news and we'll see how we go for the day. Target is extending its presence in the Big Apple. The discount giant plans to open a small format 33,000 square foot store at Tishman's Ewok Retail Complex on 42nd Street between 7th and 8th Avenues in the heart of Times Square. That's going to open in 2 years, in 2022. Now, this store is a central component of a $60 million renovation that's underway at Tishman's four-story retail center. Now, Target has been steadily expanding its small format store portfolio. Back in August, they opened up their 100th small format store with plans to open nearly 30 more each year for the foreseeable future. So basically what's happened is Target is going from big box and they're evolving, which unfortunately a lot of retailers haven't been doing. So for Target, as usual, it's a very smart move, and they're going to keep opening these stores in major urban metros in order to capitalize on appropriate consumer product inventory for that audience, because they're very good about that. And they're opening these small format stores to capitalize on local traffic that can't get to one of their bigger box stores. So for them, congratulations, it's very smart. The Times Square location is going to be Target's 10th small format store in Manhattan. Now, they already have locations in Tribeca and the East Village. They just opened one up on Columbus Circle, or they're opening one up on Columbus Circle, excuse me, Washington Heights, and Hell's Kitchen. And they're doing this in other major metros too. So Target, the reason why they've always been able to stay ahead of the competition is because they're always evolving and they're always looking at their product mix and saying, how can we do it better? So for Target, congratulations. This is wonderful news. Can't wait to see what you do next. Americans are starting to fizzle on beer. Alcohol consumption in the U.S. has dropped for the third straight year, according to CNN, with beer sales dipping another 1.5%. So you've got the big breweries like Budweiser, Coors, Miller, who once basically ruled the beverage market. They're seeing massive sales declines, but it's not just them. It's also the craft breweries. Craft breweries, because there was such a meteoric rise in that sector for so many years, now it's starting to decline, and unfortunately, they're a victim of their own success. Back in the 80s and 90s, you had this category called flavored malt beverage, FMB, where, you know, you had Bartles and James, you had Old English, OE, as we used to call it on the street, those kinds of brands. Now, they disappeared for a long time. Recently, you had a resurgence of brands like Zima, which we hadn't seen since basically the mid-90s. So with that came this explosion of craft breweries, and, you know, then you had people starting to create brands like Spiked Seltzer. So Spiked Seltzer, canned wine, pre-made cocktails are on the rise. Why? Because they're perceived to be a little bit healthier and easier to consume. So sales of domestic beer has slipped about 5% between October 18 and October 19, so year over year. So consumers are starting to pivot their tastes over to these sort of flavored beverages like spiked seltzer and canned wine. Now, pre-made cocktails, I've launched a number of those kinds of brands. Like I did Bacardi Mojito, Bacardi Raspberry Mojito. I did Jose Cuervo's Margarita, pre-made cocktails. When you do those kinds of alternative drink categories, and you know what your audience is looking for from a flavor perspective, capitalizing on that becomes a lot easier. In this trend, unfortunately, what's going on is the spirits companies aren't keeping up, and the beer companies are having an even bigger challenge because they're fighting both the craft breweries as well as these spiked seltzer brands, canned wine, and pre-made cocktails. So it's going to be interesting to see how they claw their way back. All right, SoftBank is selling its nearly 50% stake in WAG. Now, according to anonymous sources, the startup, which offers on-demand dog walking services in the U.S. through their app, will also be cutting a significant number of jobs. Here's what's going on. SoftBank got spanked for the cancellation of planned share sales of sale of shares of WeWork. You remember what happened there. Now, they're being scrutinized in a lot of different ways. So SoftBank, for the first time in its history, reported a loss this quarter. The issue at hand for SoftBank is they've got losses stemming on WeWork. This morning it came out that Goldman Sachs is putting $1.7 billion into WeWork as a line of credit. So take that aside for 1 second. That's bad enough. WAG unto itself is a problem child investment for SoftBank. They're being sued by a lot of people for professional misconduct, for theft, for loss, all of those kinds of things. What happens is a lot of millennials in this sort of, when you look at the side hustle generation and what they're doing, the issue at hand is you go onto an app, you book a walker, and basically a total stranger enters your home and starts to take care of your dog. Okay, well, they've had dozens of dogs that have been lost, some that have been killed, and there have been issues of theft. So when you calculate all of that, SoftBank had poured $300 million into WAG Labs last year. And what's going on right now is they're looking at all of the potential issues in their ownership portfolio. That's one of the reasons why they're dumping this. Now, in other news around WAG, Petco has done a partnership with them where they're promoting the service in their stores. Now, I'm hoping, I'm praying that this is the furthest that Petco is going to go with respect to WAG, because there are just too many things that can go wrong with an app like this. And I've seen it personally too many times. Now, remember, in the interest of full disclosure, Petco and Petco Foundation supports Rock'em Rawhide, our charity that helps increase the level of adoptions of dogs and cats in shelters and rescues. So when I look at what's going on with WAG and the fact that SoftBank is pulling out, the fact that Petco is promoting their services, I'm really, really hoping that WAG gets their act together and figures out a better way to monitor and control their walkers. But only time will tell. Hudson has revamped its retail format. The company, which operates more than 1,000 doors in airports, commuter hubs, landmarks, and tourist destinations across the country, is rolling out a new concept. Launching in key markets starting early next year, the next generation of Hudson stores will feature digital displays that allow for localized consumer content. Now, this is very interesting because we talked about this a few weeks ago on the Daily Mix TV. If you can get localized custom content and you're a national brand, you're ahead of the pack by a country mile. Here's why. People look for localization in big stores. And, you know, the perfect example of what not to do on the other side of that scale is Walgreens. Walgreens had basically solidified their planogram across country. So every single store has the same product, has the same look and feel, no matter what city or market you're in. That does not work, because when you look at a city like New York and you go to Walgreens Duane Reade Holding and you want to buy a upscale shampoo that's no longer available, well, you're going to go to CVS. The reason why they did this was to cut costs. So now what Hudson is doing is customizing content and actually customizing each store based on the way that they've actually built out this concept. The store model is flexible and can be adapted, And that's very interesting from a convenience retail point of view. They can change the format of the store at any time to meet the local needs of airport travelers. They've got interchangeable modular walls that allows them to transition between retail offerings. Now, whether it's enhancing product offerings, creating a seasonal display, or making swift changes to the latest hot products on display, this store can make it happen. Now, not to mention, after successful pilots, Hudson's next generation store concept is going to include self-checkout stations. For them, that is a very smart move. Why? Because when you look at Amazon Go and how successful that is in major urban metros, when you figure how busy airport travelers actually are, so many cut it so close to get to that gate. So for them to go in and be able to tap and go without having to interact with anybody is a smart move. So I'm looking forward to seeing how Hudson does. All right. You know, over the last couple of weeks, we've talked about Dunkin' Donuts at White Castle and how they've got their new online stores for merchandise and clothing and those kinds of things. Well, not to be outdone, McDonald's has launched Golden Arches Unlimited. It's an online shop that celebrates the brand with themed merchandise specifically designed for McDonald's fans. It's the chain's first ever permanent e-commerce shop. Now, it's going to be online 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all year round. Whereas Dunkin' and White Castle are closing their stores after the holiday season. And they're going to have really fun merchandise like a winter collection that includes a holiday sweater emblazoned with the chain's signature golden arches, a Happy Meal t-shirt, and so on. Now, since the 80s, McDonald's has partnered with multiple fashion brands and retailers. And beginning about 2 years ago, the company launched its own limited time line of merchandise through the McDelivery collection. Now, there are more than 20 branded items available on Golden Arches Unlimited, including tumblers, t-shirts, socks, the whole thing. Now, although large quantities are limited according to McDonald's, they're going to restock and keep updating merchandise on a regular basis. So for McDonald's, this is a very smart move because everybody who is a fan of McDonald's loves the Golden Arches. Just like when we were kids, we used to love Ronald McDonald. So it's going to be interesting to see how McDonald's does compared to the other two. Only time will tell, and we'll keep an eye on it for you. Again, I'm really sorry about my voice, guys. I know it's hard to understand me, but there's not much that I can do right now. Now, if you're a fan of Pier 1 Imports, you may have noticed that your local store has started to have a closing sale. This follows the company's announcement 2 months ago that it would be shuttering at least 70 locations. Stores in Hawaii and Alaska are already holding liquidation sales, and Pier 1 is closing all of the stores in those two states. Now, the company has not stated what other locations are going to close and what states are going to be affected, but they did state that the closures are part of a strategic business decision. Now, this comes as Pier 1 is fighting to not become another retail casualty of 2019. In its most recent quarter, the company reported that net sales were down about 14% compared to the same time last year. So, for Pier 1, it's really, really important for them to clean up their bottom line so that they can get back to growth and get back to real business. Now, there's a twist on the classic Snickers bar hitting shelves. The Mars own brand announced the launch of Snickers White. Featuring the same ingredients included in the classic bar, peanuts, nougat, and caramel, the company added a twist by covering it in all white chocolate. Previously only available for a limited time, Snickers White is now going to become a permanent part of the brand's portfolio. Quote, "We received a resounding positive response from fans when we launched Snickers White as a limited edition offering last year. As we continue to see the demand for white chocolate grow, we're excited to present this new take on our classic Snickers for more fans to enjoy." And that's Josh Alkin, who's the brand director at Snickers for Mars. Now, consumers can expect to see Snickers White hitting retailers in January, and that's going to be in a 1.41 and 2.84 ounce size bar. So that's the thing about flavor programming in limited editions. It allows you to test flavor programming to see if your audience wants it. So for them, congratulations. We all know how much of a fan I am of Snickers, especially since we named our dog Snickers. In entertainment news, again, guys, I'm really sorry. In entertainment news, Warner has finally released the trailer to the hotly anticipated Wonder Woman 1984. Check it out for yourself.
My life hasn't been what you probably think it has. We all have our struggles.
Have you ever been in love?
A long, long time ago. You?
So many times. Yeah, all the time.
Welcome to the future. Life is good, but it can be better. And why shouldn't it be? All you need is to want it. Think about finally having everything you always wanted.
I can save today, but you can save the world.
I take what I want in return.
Everyone will see.
The world needs you. You know what you need to do.
Nothing good is born from lies. And greatness is not what you think.
It's all art. That's just a trash can.
It's just a trash can.
Yeah.
That's right. The sequel to the 2017 runaway hit Wonder Woman, which grossed nearly $1 billion at the box office, is going to hit theaters next June. I love the first film, but something tells me I'm going to love this way more. The authenticity on the set designs and iconography alone for a 1984 look are spot on. So I can't wait to see what it looks like. All right, for this week's Way Back Wednesday and the last story of the day, sad news out of the music business yesterday morning as the co-founder of Roxette, Marie Fredriksson, passed away at the age of 61 after a long battle with cancer. From the mid-80s into the 90s, the Swedish duo that was Roxette had several number one hits in the US, including The Look, Listen to Your Heart, It Must Have Been Love, and Joyride. You know, Roxette at that time period, in 1988, EMI decided they wanted to take them out of Sweden and launch them with their album Look Sharp in the United States. But it wasn't until 1990 when everything exploded when It Must Have Been Love was actually featured in Pretty Woman. MTV and VH1 were playing the music video 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So that led to Generation X really adopting this band. And it was at a critical time when you started to see the transition out of pop music into alternative rock. But for those diehard 80s fans, Roxette certainly kept that volume going. So, you know, rest in peace, Marie. I just honestly, I'm so sad because I really love that band. And they have a lot of memories for me. All right, guys, I'm out of time, and unfortunately, I'm out of energy. So I will see you guys either tomorrow or Friday. It depends on how I feel. But I do appreciate you watching. If you guys have any questions, comments, or story ideas, please email thedailymixtv@gmail.com. Have a great day, guys. We'll see you soon.